Thanks everybody for being here. My name is, like your beautiful hostess correctly said, Günter Verheyen, which is the most unspeakable name outside of Belgium, because that's where I live. I live in Belgium, in Antwerp, the beautiful city of Antwerp. I work for Scrum the Dog. They're based in Boston, Massachusetts, so they sort of distributed these across the world. I do some stuff over there, like the professional series, the courses that we have, the assessments we have. Does somebody know about it already? Have you ever met our assessments or any other? At least five people, it's good. Yeah, George, I know you. Okay, cool. Glad to be talking here about scaled professional Scrum. Sometimes you'll find me coughing a little bit because I've got a bit of a cold. So yesterday I went through a sort of climate shock, starting in Belgium, rain, like 12 degrees Celsius, and then suddenly 1 hour later, like 3 hours later, arriving here, sun, summer, my wife is so jealous of me. I'm here for work, which is spicy. I've seen a couple of things yesterday. So let's talk about scale professional stuff. And first let me do a little survey to get to know you guys a little bit better. If you think of your organization, the organization you work with, whatever, what's sort of the development process that you're following or trying to follow? Does somebody use things like lean, but lean for software development, not like all the lean management crap? Lean people, a bit of lean for software development. Anybody using Kanban for their software development process? Anybody using the next hype, DevOps? Huh? Safe? Somebody implementing Safe to scale? Are you going to say yes to every question I have?
I'm from Belgium as well.
Okay. Anybody knowing that disciplined agile delivery, implementing it, trying to implement it?
Parts
of it. Anybody doing extreme programming? No. The most misunderstood process sort of that we have, and the most. Probably one of the most valuable that we should be talking about. Anybody know in Scrum? Oh, lots of hands go up. Keep up your hands. See if we can have some additional hands. Anybody doing something that we say, well, I think it's Scrum, it looks like Scrum, we claim it's Scrum, it's probably not good. Anybody doing that? Okay, it's okay to admit it. I won't bite you. Okay, so there seems to be a lot of people doing Scrum, or at least something that looks like Scrum. That's good. I just asked this, anybody doing the Spotify model?
The Spotify.
It's just with my friends of Spotify, I was talking with them yesterday. There seems to be this sort of rage across the world, people want to implement the Spotify model. They've never presented it as a model, they present it from principles and beliefs by it. It's great how we interpret things. So, are we going to do Safe or are we going to do the Spotify model? We like to stick to what we know, which is Scrum, which is that little simple kernel of every possible product development or product management lifecycle stuff we can set up. We focus as Scrum the Dog on that little thing that's called Scrum and try to maintain the simplicity of it and help you deal with complexity through the simplicity of Scrum. Sort of what we do. So, quick look back at Scrum. It was sort of the first time publicly presented in 1995. So we're celebrating 20 years of Scrum this year, so that's cool. And the funny thing with Scrum, it's always been designed to help people deal with complexity, complex problems, developing complex products in very complex circumstances. That's all the two aspects of complexity that we have. There's a Stacy chart we can use to indicate that, hey, software development actually is taking place in the complex domain. Meaning a lot of people seem to think it's simple and then act as if it's simple and run into major problems. In general, they end up in the chaos domain. If you think the problem is simple while it's complex and you pretend it's simple, you act as if it's simple, you do command and control types of things, you'll end up in chaos or unpredictable stuff anyway. I have to speak a little bit more silent because I'm interrupting Andy. So it's always been designed for complexity, the process. It thrives on what we call empirical process control, continuously, frequently, regularly inspecting very often so that you can adapt. Instead of trying to predict the rest of the world for the rest of the 3 years, inspect and adapt. Make up plans, but be aware that your plans will change, so inspect on them, adapt them. That's how how we deal with complexity. It's about people's creativity, controlling risk via time boxing. With regards to time boxing, I just agree with Andy who's speaking on the other side. Don't go run off them, please stay here, but I agree with Andy that we're going to stick to our time box and we're going to stop at 1 o'clock. Just not to ruin off the schedule of the rest of the day at least. But there's value in time boxing. And the idea of time boxing, it's hard. But you know what, we can maximize the time that we have in the time box. And I'll try to give you as much value I think I can give. That would be good. So there's a lot of things that are not always associated with scrum, but I think it's about people, it's about creativity, it's about creating boundaries within which people can use their creativity, within which people can self-organize, because as you now know, self-organization is not the same as anarchy and chaos. It's self-organizing within boundaries, against goals, against objectives, and then organizing your daily work in a sprinting world. It's an environment in which you can take action, do something, instead of being paralyzed and thinking and designing and analyzing. Do something, see whether it works, test it out, release it, see, get some feedback, do something differently. That's absolutely essentially Scrum, and that's what the process should be serving. Now, Scrum thrives on what we call Scrum's DNA. This is essential to Scrum, and this should be in every implementation of Scrum. You should be able to recognize this. Whether you do Scrum with one team or whether you're a full organization of Scrum, this should always be at the heart of whatever you do. That's why we call it Scrum's DNA. It should be the genetic material of every Scrum implementation. It's based upon self-organization. People self-organizing the work towards certain goals, certain objectives, but it's self-organization. And it's about empiricism, frequently inspecting and adapting where you are. So this should reoccur in every implementation of Scrum, and it's probably some of the most difficult parts of Scrum. Self-organization and empiricism, very important. Now, what we've seen since the creation of the conceptual scope of the Agile Manifesto 2001, there's been some sort of crazy thing going on. It's a friend of ours, a trainer in Poland, called it the Scrum Beat. You know the English word stampede? Like a herd of cows or deers or whatever, all running in one direction, so a massive amount, they're all running towards something. They ask themselves, where are we running to? I have no idea, but they're going there too. I want to go there too. So nobody knows why, but they're all running in the same direction. So since the creation of the Agile Manifesto, it seems that everybody wants to do Scrum because they want to be Agile too, they want to do Agile, but they have no idea why they do Scrum. They do Scrum because of Scrum, they do Scrum because the other people are also doing Scrum. It's not really helpful for them, although it creates a great foundation to help people improve. So that's sort of what we see happening. A lot of people doing Scrum for, I don't know, whatever reason, several reasons, very diverse people. So we can help those people. We can help those people by always going back to the basics of Scrum. So Scrum essentially is, let's call it a sort of system, and it's a system in which you have a product backlog, getting requirements, all the things you need to do for a certain product. That's why it's called product backlog, so you get a software product in general. You list up a lot of things, you order them, and those are the things you think you need to do, you keep inspecting and adapting it, so it's a living thing. But it's the input for what we call in general team, a team, let's keep it simple, one Scrum team. They all work from the product backlog with the purpose of within a time box sprint of 2, 3, 4 weeks, whatever time box you use, creating what we call a releasable increment, a DOM increment. An increment is supposed to be releasable, meaning it should have all the qualities that you want or your organization wants in there to put it on the market. So you can close the feedback loop with your users, your customers, your consumers, and get a feedback from that, use that to adapt your product. That's the simple idea of a Scrum system. Product backlog as input, and the output of the system would be a releasable increment every 2 or 3 weeks. Now, that sounds simple. It doesn't seem to be that simple, but anyhow, that's sort of the idea. Yeah? And that's driving on, so within the system, it's driving on self-organization and criticism. Very good. So, what I always say to people, what if you would start doing Scrum first? Let's say doing Scrum properly, professionally, before we start scaling it. Because if you don't do Scrum properly, not even with one team, if you start scaling that, what are you actually scaling? It's probably not Scrum. It's something that looks like Scrum, not helpful. In general, you would be scaling your dysfunctions instead of scaling the benefits of Scrum. So the idea. So keep it simple, do Scrum first, with a couple of things, one team, do it properly, and then start scaling up. That's also iterative incremental progress, right? You adopt Scrum in a Scrum way, iteratively, incrementally. That's very important. Just some things, but yeah? I'm not doing this with Scrum part, but then we come into this idea of scaled Scrum. And I've got a little question here for that. So, have you seen this sort of second phase of that Scrum beat? First, everybody was running towards, we want to do Scrum, we want to do Scrum. And since a couple of years, so in 2012, we've seen companies, a lot of people and organizations saying, oh, we have to scale Scrum, we've been doing Scrum, we've been there, we've seen that, we know Scrum, we have to scale it because we want more software, we want it quicker, higher productivity, higher velocity thing. Have you seen that happening in Greece or not yet? If you haven't seen it happening, be prepared, it's coming. And people have no idea what they're doing. Because if you don't first do Scrum and then start scaling Scrum, it's maybe not really scaling Scrum. And there's a little other problem, and let's do a little survey about it. What is scaling? Or what is scaled or at scale, whatever we use? Because there seems to be a lot of definitions. It's sort of like a Rorschach thing, where you're at a psychologist, you ask you, what do you see in this? And everybody will see something differently. So let's do a little survey to that. So raise your hand if your organization or yourself, whatever, define scale as we've got multiple teams working on one product. Who would say this is scale? Or whose organization says, oh, okay, this is scale. Another definition of scaling. We've got multiple teams and they all work on their own product. Scaling, somebody? Yeah, okay, cool. We've got multiple teams and they work on a set of integrated products. So there's a number of integrated products, or product suites or product lines that have multiple teams working on it. That's what this is here. Another definition, we've got one team and they have to work on like 3, 4, 5 products at the same time. That's scale, right? It's nice. So anybody say, organization, we work like this, this is what we call scale? No. A friendly advice in this situation, one sprint, one product. Focus, transparency, knowing what you're doing, avoiding context switching resources. Maybe not really scaling, this is just... Now, all scaling means a full IT department or whatever big, small, large institute that we work up need to adopt Scrum. That's scale. Who's working on it and say, oh, full IT has to go to Scrum. Okay, and overnight probably. Scale means that the complete organization needs to be agile. That's from tomorrow. Who says this is scale? So there's a lot of definitions of what is scale, what might be scaling. As Scrum guys, we like to keep it simple again, always go back to basics and look at what's in the term. So, there's a lot of things going on. There's probably scaling in your product development, using Scrum or other methodologies. There's things that we call organizational improvement or organizational transformation. We see scaled Scrum as over there. Scaled Scrum has nothing to do with organization. There will be organizational impact, but Scrum in itself does not have the tools, the instruments, immediately to tell you how to reorganize your organization towards being more technical, whatever. Scale Scrum means you do Scrum for your product development, and you would want to do that at a bit higher scale. Let's say beyond one team. Couple of teams working together. And we've got two definitions of scale Scrum, just to be really clear about it. It's multiple teams building one product, or multiple teams building related products. For the rest of this introduction, let me keep to the first definition, because we know what Scrum is for one team. Let's see how we can, with multiple Scrum teams, build one product and how we can improve. Multiple teams working on each of their own separate, distinct products, that is a lot of Scrum, not necessarily scaled Scrum. Because every single team just does sort of single Scrum, that's not necessarily scaled Scrum. So let's look at that first idea. Multiple teams building one product. Well, it should still be a Scrum system. You should recognize Scrum's DNA in it. Self-organization, criticism, use of inspection, adaptation techniques. And it should be a system that is thriving on pulling work from a product backlog, because you're working on one product, so you have one product backlog. You're pulling work from one product backlog with multiple teams, but the outcome of the Scrum system should still be releasable increments by the end of every sprint of 2, 3, 4, whatever things that you do. Every more than 4 weeks. Okay? So that's the idea. The increments should be releasable, meaning obviously with multiple teams it should be integrated. Otherwise you can't release, right? If you've got like every team producing its own piece of software in its own branch of the code, that's not releasable. Well, it puts a couple of additional demands, but a Scrum system should be recognizably driving on self-organizations to pull the work from product backlog and giving output a releasable increment by the end of every sprint. So we'll come back to that, but there's probably a couple of problems that that's stood out. Let's cut the time off a little bit. Will you take 1, maybe 2 minutes to talk with the people around you and say, hey, we're trying to do scale Scrum, we're trying to scale up Scrum, and these are the problems that we are facing in our organization. Yeah? We'll take 2 minutes and talk to the people next to you. Do a little exercise and talk about one of the biggest hurdles you see when going for the scale implementation of Scrum. You might end up talking about doing Scrum at all, but yeah, take 2 minutes for that. Talk with each other. Investigations, what works better, something. So the room for technical excellence. like good coding, good development practices, good engineering practices, things like that. Think on extreme programming, by the way. If you have built it, read the books. They've got some great techniques you can use within Scrum. Scrum is a framework. It creates boundaries. Within those boundaries, there are tons of engineering practices that you might want to use. And you should be using some of that. Just having the boundaries in place is probably not enough. It's just a start. So what we often see as a problem is, well, if we have to work with multiple teams on one problem, we have to keep our work integrated, because that's what Scrum wants us to do. Now let's forget about that. So, and you get these type of code bases, and if you look at it, you're sort of scared. It's what I call the Medusa effect. You know, you probably know Medusa, right? The beautiful lady with the snakes in her hair. So you look at the code base, and you want to quickly turn away, because it will turn you into stone for the rest of your days. You will be paralyzed, it's so ugly you don't want to look at it. But unfortunately, in software development, avoiding looking at the code base is probably not really helpful, because that's what we do. We build code bases, we build good software, don't get it out to the market. So if you have poorly maintained code bases, it's going to be pretty difficult to really scale Scrum. Because it's full of technical debt, it's full of problems and things. I'll come back to that. So think about this, the Medusa effect of looking at the poorly, oh no, I don't want to go there, keep me away from that. But not always helpful. Might use a few, but let's have a look at that code base again. So let's look at this Scrum system again. So you've got one Scrum team pulling work from a product backlog, and they have to go via that poorly maintained code base to hopefully get a reasonable increment out. That's still pretty feasible, because they work in a very specific area of the code base, they've got full control, nothing else is interfering with them, whatever. So the chances are that they are actually able to produce a reasonable increment by the end of the sprint. Now, if you have a couple of Scrum teams doing that same work in a poorly maintained code base, meaning they pull work from the product backlog, then they go off, they do their sprints, they get their sprint backlogs, they do the daily scrums, whatever. So that one team still, oh, we have this clear picture of what we need to do, but then there's these other teams coming in, and they work in different parts of the code base, and there's some overlap, or they use the same services, they want to adapt the same interfaces, want to work in the same parts of the database. And suddenly, even one team loses the perspective of where we are. But the chances are, it's still feasible, maybe with some effort, to produce a reasonable increment by the end of every sprint. If you have many Scrum teams pulling work from one product backlog, a product has a product backlog, they all pull work from it, with the intent of producing a reasonable increment by the end of every sprint, and you've got, like in this case, 9 or even more Scrum teams. With 3 Scrum teams, you were already there. With 9 Scrum teams, it's just a mess. You have no idea what you're doing. Imagine what are the chances that those people are able to create a reasonable increment by the end of the sprint. It's almost not feasible. You have to see it's working a lot. And why? Because that system, from the beginning to the end, is full of unresolved dependencies. It's not only dependencies in the code base, interfaces, shared things, shared code, and whatever. Even if you have a source control system in place, which sort of surprisingly a lot of big organizations don't really have proper version control in place, which is sort of strange. But even then, there are dependencies, technical dependencies, development dependencies. There are probably dependencies in the product backlog, items that depend on each other that we need to communicate about. There are dependencies between the teams. There are dependencies inside of the teams. Skills, experience that are available, not available, work that can be done, cannot be done, whatever. So this system is full of dependencies. And we think this is the biggest hurdle in scaling product development. Not only with Scrum, every type of scaled product development system is full of dependencies. With one team, you've got limited dependencies. With a couple of teams, more dependencies. With 9 or more teams working on one system, it's full of dependencies. And what we see is that a lot of people think that by just focusing on the process, those dependencies will be resolved. Oh, maybe not. And there are other people that think, oh, we're not able to produce releasable increments by the end of every sprint, so because our work doesn't integrate, let's keep adding features to that. Maybe someday it will magically integrate again. I've never seen that happening, but please keep up the belief, keep dreaming about that. Maybe it will happen someday. Keep adding features to a non-integrating system and maybe it will happen someday. So there's a number of dependencies, they're all over the place, they're inside of teams, they're across teams, they're between teams and the outside world. maybe like dependencies on budgeting, forecasts, deadlines that you have to make, those funny things, legal aspects, EU regulations. Some people have to follow EU regulations. I hope you'll be school is free of all of that, by the way. So it's full of dependencies and lots of dimensions. So that's core to scale process development. Because if you don't resolve your dependencies over time, you might be ending up in this situation that by the beginning, you're still able to spend all of your money on new features. Great. But dependencies keep growing. You don't resolve them timely, not soon enough, not regularly. They keep building up. And at some point in time, you're spending all of your money on fighting technical debt. Instead of creating new features, innovative ideas for your users, you're just solving unresolved dependencies. That's sort of an effect. This is sort of product owner message. Where do you want to spend your money on? Fighting technical debt or building new stuff for your users? So would you allow your development team to really self-organize and have room for technical excellence? Or are you going to keep pushing them towards more software, more? You can use Scrum to produce a lot more software in shorter time periods, in a way that you can produce also more crap in shorter time periods. So you can use to go for Scrum and build really excellent high quality products. So it's a choice. It's still Scrum, it's how you want to use Scrum. In general, the ability to scale depends on the ability to deal with dependencies proactively, but also what we call redefining them. I'll come back to that. Integrate your work and make sure that you keep creating integrated increments. Don't release more increments, you'll be able to put them out in the market. Now there's this funny thing, I don't know how it's in Greece, but really Belgium and the Netherlands have been working on in industry, big companies, banks and so on. They all want to go for continuous delivery now. You see that happening too? So people are not able to produce a releasable integrated increment every 3 weeks, but the ambition is to do it like every second. So, let's take it step by step. I won't forget about continuous delivery now and just do plainly Scrum and produce a list within the end of 2 weeks. That would be a huge improvement, I think, for the organization. And you would have lots of room for inspection and annotation. So let's look at what we've called the Nexus. It's a framework. Who has heard about the Nexus already? Cool. Look up, there's a Nexus guide. So who knows about the Scrum guide? Okay. Who's also read the Scrum guide? Oh, more hands go, that's cool. Great. So there's a Scrum guide out there somewhere, Scrum Guide Support, whatever, maintained by Ken and Jeff, two co-creators of Scrum. We recently published what we call a Nexus guide, so describing the Nexus. Let me quickly go into what we see as the Nexus. Let's start with a little definition. Nexus, it's probably from old Greek or old Latin? Latin probably. It's about what we see as how can we build up connections between people, between teams, so that they can self-organize better towards producing releasable software. So it's not about process, it's about communication, it's about collaboration. Sort of the hidden secrets to proper product development, collaboration between people, interfacing, communication, etc. So how can you build up? So that's where we got the name Nexus from. So we've got, let's say, 3 to 9 teams building one process, and of people, oh, help me, how can I still do something that looks like Scrum without adding overhead of phases again and additional roles and so on, and without overruling Scrum's DNA, so without destroying Scrum's genetic material. Okay? How can we do that? Well, this is how the Nexus does it. So this is sort of how every sprint works within the Scrum system. A Nexus is intended to interconnect 3 to 9 Scrum teams together building one product. Meaning you've got one product backlog that gives input to the sprint of the several teams, 3 to 9 teams. They do a Nexus sprint planning, you do separate sprint plannings as a team, so that there's an overall picture and a picture to team. They, new artifact, they keep in place what we call a Nexus sprint backlog. A sprint backlog, so the artifacts in Scrum, they serve transparency. They should make information available, transparent, understandable, and so on. So if you have 3 to 9 teams working on one product, there's a lot of dependencies. The Nexus sprint backlog serves to make the transparencies within the sprint across the teams, the dependencies transparent, so that people know about them. We've identified a possible new role, which we call the Nexus integration team. It's a Scrum team, so it's set up as a Scrum team, as a Scrum Master Protocol development team, but their focus is integration. Now people think that if you say their focus, even accountability, is integration, that they have to do the integration work. Now that's not true. They are like a servant leadership team for the rest of the Nexus with regards to integration. The idea is still to have 3 to 9 Scrum teams. They actually do the integration. It's their job to do it, preferably on a daily basis. But there's a Nexus integration team that might facilitate them with tools, infrastructure, knowledge, guidance, guidelines, and so on. So they make sure that within a Nexus, which is a pretty complex system, by the way, imagine nine Scrum teams, and highly skilled professional Scrum developers, 80 of them, 81 of them, sort of. That's a lot of software you can produce. If you manage to produce integrated software, you want to be able that's a possible new role within the Nexus, a Nexus integration team. It's a Scrum team, but it's like being a Scrum Master within a team. It's like being a servant leader for the rest of the Nexus with regards to integration. Now, what we see, a lot of people actually do that already. We've just solidified and codified a number of existing practices, beliefs that we have, in a more solid system, a cohesive framework. It's based on ideas that Ken Schreiber has been promoting for years and years and years. If you look at Scrum in the Enterprise from 2007, it's already full of these ideas. But what is so good about it, it seems, for the outside world, it now has a name that's important to talk about. It's called Nexus. And it's more codified in the Scrum Guide. So, and you will recognize the Scrum process. It's probably backlogs, sprint planning, sprint backlogs, knowing daily Scrums as a team, but also across the Nexus, so you can identify dependencies within the Nexus regularly, and at least every day, so you can deal with them. So the idea of a Nexus, at the core of the Nexus, is integrated work. It's not about process, it's about keeping the work integrated. If at the daily Scrum, Nexus daily Scrum, you find out that the work is not integrating anymore, and you want to split up to your teams again and see what is the best plan for our team to follow today, I would hope that they would resolve the unintegrated work first before adding support. You never know what they do, but that might be a focus. Or you might run into a very painful sprint review by the end of the sprint for the full Nexus, where you must admit, oh my god, we haven't focused on integration, so it's not releasable, which is painful for the stakeholders, product owner, and so on. Yeah. So you will recognize Scrum. There's a retrospective that has 2-3 components. There's an aspect of identifying improvements that are applicable to the full Nexus that might influence improvements for your individual team, and you want to be able to communicate about those things. But this is the Nexus, what we call an exoskeleton. It's like 3 to 9 Scrum teams, and they're not doing individual Scrum anymore. They're doing Scrum as a group, as a team, a collaborative, a network of teams. And this identifies how you might implement Scrum for those 3 to 9 teams. Because the idea is still to have input, product backlog, and output, a releasable increment by the end of every 2-3 weeks. And this is how you might use Scrum in order to interconnect 3 to 9 Scrum teams. Yeah. So the idea of the Nexus. Yeah. So Nexus has some tactics in place within the framework to deal with dependencies. They're proactive, trying to identify and resolve dependencies before they actually happen by doing proper product backlog management, doing more refinement probably. That's probably you want to do. If you're working with one Scrum team, you probably can do even without product backlog refinement if you want. If you're working with 3 to 9 Scrum teams, your sprint planning will be very messy and very chaotic if you haven't refined your product backlog before. So there's more focus on things like that. Revealing dependencies, that's what we call reification, making things transparent so you can act upon it, making things, dependencies, actionable by doing frequently integration work. Continuous integration system, test-driven development, all beautiful practices to deal with dependencies as soon as possible. No longer at the point in time where they mess up the total system and have turned into technical debt by releasing a lot of software for you. Just beautiful practices, because there are always dependencies that you can't proactively identify, deal with. They will happen. There will be unresolved dependencies in your system. Deal with them as soon as possible, preferably at that Nexus daily scrum. Not let things accumulate beyond control. That's sort of the idea. So that's the idea of Nexus, helping people deal with complex problems and certainly in a scaled environment dealing with dependencies. It's a different way of thinking about people. Yes, might be different, but it's still Scrum. The funny thing, scaled Scrum should still be Scrum. If you don't have that Scrum DNA in place, it's probably no longer something like real Scrum or proper Scrum. And that's not because of the sake of calling it Scrum, it's just because of having the benefits of Scrum. Being agile, being able to release software frequently, gather feedback, incorporate feedback, being flexible, responsiveness, and those things. That's what Scrum is about. So all those companies rushing into Scrum without knowing why. It helps if you have a purpose. It helps if you have a sort of why in place. Why are we doing Scrum? What are we hoping to achieve by doing Scrum? We'll have. Don't do Scrum because of Scrum. Use Scrum as a tool to achieve something. Might be more like a mental message, maybe, but still very important. Yeah. So reification, very important. The last sort of responsible moment for reification within Scrum is that sprint review, where you do an inspection of the increment, and where you might find very painful that it's not integrated, that it's not releasable. Good, last responsible moment. Maybe do it on a daily basis, or it's a lot better than. Then allow those 3 to 9 teams to organize their own work. Give them the goal. The goal is by the end of every sprint producing releasable software. That's a challenging goal. Stop telling them how they should do that on a day-to-day basis. Give them that goal. That's the Scrum. So the Nexus organized Scrum. I'm focused on the Nexus integration team. There's a number of practices that we've added to scale professional sprints. It builds on top of the Nexus. So Nexus is sort of the Scrum engine, sort of the core, that kernel for 3 to 9 Scrum team. We've extended that a little bit in what we call scaled professional Scrum. With a number of practices that can use, they've been made up, they've been formulated to help you deal with dependencies proactively or via reification. They are optional, they should be tuned to your context. They're not like blindly to be followed, look at them. I know Spotify does a lot with microservices. That's really great. I need to be agile. Not an easy thing to do, but have a look at it. I want to pick out two last practices and then my time box is over. Descaling. The best possible scaling practice that you might find is descale. If you have a number of teams working together and you're not able to produce releasable software by the end of every sprint, descale. Start doing work with less teams until you reach that point again of being able to produce reasonable software, and then start adding teams again. Be professional in your Scrum, have room for technical excellence, and maybe if you descale, you're able to produce so much software that you don't need to add teams again. That might be a fascinating challenge. So descale, because we all think that productivity will increase linearly with adding people and adding teams. It doesn't happen. It's not like we add 3 teams and suddenly our velocity productivity goes up by a factor of 3 too. It's not like that. That's not complexity. That's linear simplistic thinking. So at some point in time, adding teams will probably maybe flatten your productivity. All of the additional overhead of adding teams goes into additional dependencies and in additional value. And it might be even worse. By adding teams, you might be even decreasing your productivity. Your productivity might go beyond zero. You're only dealing with technical dependencies instead of producing beautiful things. You might want to already call Scrumble, not just descale. Just stop doing Scrum. Stop trying out every possible process you can. Just fix your problems in your code base first, and then start doing something Scrum. So descaling and Scrumble. Probably the two most important factors of that can promote scale professional staff. The two hardest to understand also to get it. Yeah? This is sort of a rush to the Nexus, Scrum, scale, professional Scrum and Nexus. I hope you take home some ideas, start implementing on them. I'm going to stop because I'm at the end of my time. And you know what? I'm at the end of my presentation here. Cool. Thanks for being here.
Yeah. but this time it worked.
Okay. So I would imagine that this team that makes taking care of the backlog of the Nexus either has to be, let's say, designer, because if we are talking about the same code base, okay, before it goes to the sprint, either they would have to design the system like this, so the teams that working on the same code base, somehow they don't touch, at least they touch the less, you know, common things in the code. So that means that you have to do many design before the actual sprint by this team, in my point of view. The other way is to, that team decides, okay, we have some features, let's find the, let's build the software in a, for example, domain driven design.
Yes.
We have to talk with the APIs, and that's the integration of the top events. So I cannot see how, what's the goal of this thing. Because you have a user story that may affect all the system, okay? The customer as a user wants to do that, and this may affect all the code. But how do you merge this? How do you
So there's a couple of things in your question, and I'll quickly, as a Scrum freak, go into them. First of all, Scrum has no idea what the concept of user stories are. That's extreme programming. There's no obligation in Scrum that your product backlog should be all user stories. It's just the product backlog captures all the work you need to do for a product, which might be architectural work too, design work. That could be part of your product backlog. That could be part of work that pulled in, that's being pulled in by the Nexus integration team to be done. The goal of Scrum is to produce always at least some sort of business value by the end of every sprint. That doesn't mean that you can't spend a majority of the sprint on maybe designing architectural work. I would hope that your organization has a good idea and good guidelines on what is a good architecture in our organization, so that teams understand the guidelines and implement upon those guidelines instead of having to do all that work up front. So there's a way to deal with architecture and designs and so on. Adding on to product backlog can be maybe done by the Nexus integration, but also correcting while building features, also adapting the architecture to completely support those features, aligning with each other, aligning with the Nexus integration team. So it can be highly dynamic. But product backlog is open for all types of requirements. The only demand that we have from Scrum is to be able to produce something of value for your users by the end of the sprint. If you have, if it was needed to do a lot of architectural work in order to use that little feature, that's
everything if you like.
So it's using the tools we have, using a product backlog, and then you might want to build some guidelines by the Nexus integration team, check whether the teams all understand them and can implement on them. So it's, in a way, trying to avoid that. That type of work, don't push it outside of the Scrum system. It's not helpful in general. We think that the Nexus integration team is indeed, like you hinted at, is probably best set up of as what we call a team of teams. Having maybe specialists with regards to integration and have them be complemented as a team by members of the individual Scrum teams. Because they know about the hard work every day, they know how it's happening, so that you have that mix within that one team. So it's best composed of a team of teams. In most situations, depending on working with 3 teams or 8 teams or 9 teams, that will probably influence how much time is required by being part of the integration team. If you're part of an individual Scrum team and an integration team, the work in the integration team prevails. That's what comes first. And it's probably best to be full-time part of the Nexus integration team, but the exact composition might change over time, depending on the demands with regards to integration. So it's a team of teams. It might be a fixed team, but it's probably going to change over time. Make it a full-time team, that's certainly very helpful. And but that's also, again, stepping away from the capacity thinking. What's the time that a team has to do spikes or to read a book? I don't care, that's capacity planning. Scrum, age of thinking is not about capacity planning. It's about producing as much value as possible, including all the work might be reading books, might be sitting on the beach, all the work, all the thinking work that's required to do as much fun as possible, away from what has to
be. And I have a quick question. This development takes into account that the sprints are stuck, are in the same time boxes, which is not necessary. It's not necessary, as I know. I mean, yeah, it is a best practice. I think that the Scrum team starts with the same time box, but that's not necessarily, you know, this is not practice in Scrum, as far as I know. So what happens if the teams have different, the Scrum team is a 2 week.
Let me quickly add two perspectives to that. So it's about sort of sprint cadence, right? Sprint cadence at scale. There's two aspects in the Nexus. Just as a sort of startup framework to help you get going, we do assume that sprints are in line with each other, meaning that in line, meaning that it doesn't have to necessarily be the same sprint length, but there needs to be some cadence, meaning a team can work on 4 weeks, another team can work on 2 weeks, but there has to be a sort of synchronized point at which they can produce software. If you really put integrated work at the heart of whatever you do, that's something you don't have to do anymore. If you're integrating your work on a daily basis and keeping it integrated on a daily basis, like Google does, by the way, one code, no branches, all happening in the main trunk. If you integrate like that, the demand for syncing your sprints, that sort of, it vanishes. But that means you have to really keep your work integrated, and then every team can organize its own sprints, and even its own sprint reviews by deducting a releasable increment from the main truck, inspecting it, releasing it as well. But that's already very, very sort of advanced.
Last question.
One more.
Speaking about, for example, the Nexus sprint planning or Nexus sprint retrospective, maybe that's like 3 to 9 teams in there, so that everybody is included into this meeting. Is it up to 100 people in this one meeting? How is it possible? How is it manageable? How do you run it?
Yeah, cool. Look at the answers you get from the Spotify guys. So by the end of this session, they answered some, stick with your principles and beliefs. And find out a way to make it happen. Believe that you can do this. There's companies actually doing it. So do a joint sprint planning, do a joint sprint review, do a joint sprint retrospective, even with other people. Put them in a big room, use the walls, use sticky notes, organize it, let themselves organize around it, do joint refinement sessions. It's actually possible. Yeah, I think
we should have one more question, because it's better for the flow to the rest of the talk.
You're the boss?
I also have one question, if you allow.
Oh, no, I don't take questions from organizers. No.
Actually, I
see
you
too.
Okay.
I think if you hold the mic,
yeah, it's the angle that matters. It has to be like my national.
What happens when the teams are distributed? I mean, which is a very difficult case for organizations that sort of work.
Well, the funny thing is even, so the question was about distributed teams. What if you have one Scrum team and you have people distributed across the world? How do you do Scrum? Well, keep doing Scrum, and instead of, Scrum's inspection and adaptation, it thrives on the right frequency. How often do you inspect and adapt? Inspection and adaptation is a way to deal with complexity. In a distributed way of working, complexity is higher. So instead of lowering the frequency, what seems to be the tendency, turn up the frequency, do more inspection and adaptation so that you keep aligning with each other. The same goes for a Nexus. If you're working with a Nexus with distributed teams across the world, keep organizing Scrum, organize your sprint planning, use electronic tools. I've seen examples of Microsoft, of all names, doing development on, I think it's TFS or Visual Studio, whatever it is, across the world. And they organize, in a way, joint sprint plannings, but they organize sprint plannings in a sort of distributed, sprint reviews in a distributed way, by having people create little movies over the features that they created, sharing them like a couple of days before the sprint review, so stakeholders, product owners get a view on that, can respond to that, give feedback and so on. So look for techniques, just keep organizing Scrum. Don't lower Scrum, do probably more Scrum, which is difficult. It's sort of like sometimes people say, we can't get anything done in 3 weeks, so let's go for 4 weeks. No, go for 2 weeks then. That's sort of the same, do more Scrum instead of less Scrum. Because you've raised complexity, do less complexity. If you can keep your teams like at least one full team in one location, that certainly helps a lot. But you never know what people do.
Hi, I work for Nokia, and I mentioned that because we have huge code complexity, dozens of teams working the same product, legacy, all these things in this kind of complexity. So I like the idea of this scrambling, but I don't think that it's so practical to stop everything, fix everything, and then continue. So I think there must be a kind of trade-off, and we give some hints on how you deal with this. I mean, you have something to deliver, new things to do, but also have all the technical debts you need to take care of. So do you allocate special slots? Let's say you have, as Nico said before, some define some roles like designers, guardians, whatever, to secure things.
Okay. Yeah, so the sort of practical trade-off. I don't like the idea of trade-offs because I'm a purist and I'm a Scrum. Some people call me a Scrum extremist. So I don't like the idea of trade-offs. And it doesn't sound practical, I fully agree. That's because life has some hard lessons for us. But still, if it's not practical, the sort of practical way to deal with technical debt is step one, stop creating additional technical debt. Have a definition of them in place that reflects releasable, so that as from now on, every new thing you build adheres to your definition of them, which is actually releasable. And then I wouldn't allocate separate time frames on certainly not sprints, but just beyond building new stuff, start resolving existing technical debt, step by step by step. It will take you out of the swamp. It will take a lot of time, maybe a lot more time than if you would just scramble. But, you know, practical triggers. So stop creating new technical debt, and then gradually, step by step, sprint after sprint after sprint after sprint, try to resolve existing technical debt. It's a long road out of hell, but still, but it starts by stop creating new technical debt. Have a definition of done in place, make sure it reflects releasable, so that every new feature, whatever you build, lives up to that definition of done, no matter how hard it is, and then look for time to start resolving existing technical debt. If you can't go for scroll. So, by the way, in the history of Scrum, there's been a lot of people saying, oh, Scrum, it doesn't work like that. We can't do it like that. Still, many people are actually doing it, so there's a lot more possible than we might. Use your imagination. It will help you a lot more.
I want to live the experience of the microphone. Did you change your mind about the organizers? About the organizers asking questions?
Yeah, I've changed my mind,
okay.
So that's what I
would like to ask you this question from the very first moment we arranged this. We know that you know very well Ken Schwaber, the creator of Scrum. Have you something to share with us as a fun story or a didactic story or something strange in his career or something that you remember for the following?
Ken once worked with a company somewhere in the US. It's a couple of years ago, and they were like, just to talk about technical debt and releasable and so on. And he worked with a couple of teams together. And for, let's say, 3 sprints in a row, sort of, they would tell the product, yeah, we're done. Sprint after sprint, we're done. Until after 3 sprints, product owner says, oh, we've got a beautiful product in place. I want to actually release this. Oh my God, it's not that sort of done. In order to release, we should also do this and this and this. But you know what? No problem. It will take us only 1 sprint. So the accumulation of ongoing work in 3 sprints, so it was not really integrated, not all the tests were successful, and which people were sort of hiding it from a product owner because they were under pressure and they need to produce and be productive and so on. So after sprints, they had what they called a release candidate. That was was the goal of the product owner. When the product owner wanted to actually release, it was not that sort of DOM. So we then worked with them just on that system, having a real definition of DOM in place and so on. But in the end, it took several sprints to resolve the technical debt of only 3 sprints. Imagine working with 3 teams together for 3 sprints in a row and not doing all of the DOM work. So, and that's just a very hard lesson. A day or two done, it might seem hard, but if you look at it from sort of mid-term perspective, it's really useful, it's really helpful. Your flow across like 6 or 9 months of work, sprint after sprint, adhering to the definition of DOM is much better than short-term solutions, undercutting quality, and so on. So be careful about it. I think everybody has some experience in releasing on-done software. Well, you know, it's not really done, let's call it done. And you know what, even worse, let's put it out there on the market. And then see what happens. See how much trust you're building with your product owner, with your stakeholders, with your users, where your credibility goes just because of. There are a zillion reasons to release on-done software. Don't go for it. And you know what, it's only 2-3 weeks of work. That's also this thinking we have. In the past, we were like, okay, we have to release. It's 9 months of work, but without a budget, there's no more time. There's a pile of change requests that we still should do, but we have to release. Now, this is only 2 weeks of work. What's so harmful about taking 2 additional weeks and getting really done? Focus on getting it done.
It's at the top floor, it's right above us, not at the entrance, it's just both.